That's what happens when Steve tries to do something different. Good morning, I'm Pastor Steve Craig. Welcome to St. John's Presbyterian Church. And for those of you who are online this morning, and there are a lot of us online right now, we want to especially welcome you and invite you to write your name in the chat window, let us know that you're here during the service today. And remember that at any time during the worship service, you can click the request prayer button, and you'll be invited by the prayer host to come to a private chat room where you can share whatever's on your heart today. This is a very special morning. We're celebrating Black History Month. We're also celebrating the life and the work of Dr. Martin Luther King. And we are very pleased to be able to welcome Gerald C. Rivers this morning, who is going to be sharing the voice of Dr. King, as well as these young people behind me, the Peace Player drummers that you're going to hear just a little bit later in the service. So it's a very special service. We're looking forward to being together in worship. And just want to remind you that we are continuing to wear masks during the service, though the county health guidelines are changing very quickly. I'm getting tested every week, and that's the reason why I'm not wearing one right now, and I'm fully boosted. So for those of us who are speaking here in this particular spot, we are taking our masks off. Also, I do want to say that there's a flower on the communion table, I believe, today, or if not, we're celebrating the birth of Lillian Orley Payne this morning to our congregation. Lillian was born on February the 19th, and I believe we have a slide picturing her beautiful little face. Is that up there? Lillian Orley Payne, she was born February 19th, 2022. You can't miss that little, there she is. Born to Kari and Sam Payne, and the happy grandparents are Stephen and Phoebe Haywood. So 7 pounds, 3 ounces, 20 inches. That's the second baby in 1 week that we've had at St. John's. So that's exciting. And Steve said her cuteness factor is 10 million percent. So we agree. And remember, for all the most up-to-date information about St. John's, its ministry, its programs, what's happening this month, the next month, you can always sign up for the newsletter through stjohnspress.org. And now would you please join me in the call to worship from Psalm 32. It's a psalm for the disinherited and the dispossessed in every age, and especially appropriate right now. Join me in Psalm 32. If you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. And the people said, be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. Into your hand I commit my spirit. Love the Lord, all you, his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts haughtily. And together, be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. That psalm was recommended by the chief rabbi in Ukraine, and that's inspired me to read it as well today. Almighty God, you are the rock. Your works are perfect and all your ways are just. A God of faithfulness and without injustice, good and upright are you. As we gather in worship, we remember those in Ukraine who gather in shelters facing a powerful adversary. And we remember those who suffer injustice in every land because of violence, racism, and poverty. Oh God, we are a world that wearies of disease and hatred and war. We pray for your truth to prevail, for justice to be done, for tyranny to end, and for peace to reign. In you we trust and commit our spirits. We ask it through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now let's continue to worship with Mel and Scott. They're going to be sharing with us online.
Good morning, St. John's. I hope you're having a wonderful Sunday morning so far. Whether you're in the sanctuary, at home, wherever you're worshiping with us today, it's a wonderful day to praise the Lord together. So would you please stand up? And let's sing some songs of praise from our hearts to God.
Send me on.
cry to the Lord this morning. If you feel like it, wherever you are, just open your arms wide and lift them up to the Lord. We read the verse for today is going to be Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord all of my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes and mortal men cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed is he whose help is in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, the Lord who remains faithful forever. Us. We open our hearts to you this morning, our minds, our souls. We offer up what we have to you and just pray that you would give us something new, something fresh to learn this morning about you. In Jesus' name, amen.
right now to greet one another. If you're online, do that using the chat function. Even if you've already said something this morning, even if you've already said hello, go ahead and say something again. It's always good just to see all those names popping up and all the people that are worshiping with us online. If you are in the service, we are doing touchless greeting. So just look around, wave, offer a friendly...
All right, we're doing something called the standstill greeting. So you just stand and pivot. Stand and pivot and wave. Turn around and wave at your neighbor. And good morning to all of you peace player drummers again. All right.
Good morning. My name is Nancy Ashley, and I'm the Director of Children and Family Ministries. Before I share with you what I have to share today, if there's any children in the congregation, we're staying in the sanctuary today to enjoy our special event. If you haven't found one yet, there are some activity pages that I would love to share with you, so there's something to do while you're listening. Anyway, I'm the Director of Children and Family Ministries, among a few other things, but last weekend, I was camp cook at our youth group's winter camp, Rooted Winter Camp in Idlewild, California. It was a great weekend, and due to the generosity of our congregation, we enjoyed a lovely time in a cabin up in Idlewild, and also thanks to the generosity of the Bomars who helped us out with all of that. Without further ado, I have a little slideshow to let you know what it was kind of like.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is looking at me. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? I can only imagine all creation bowed down, the whole universe saying your name out loud. I can only imagine.
Thank you. The theme was belonging. We all belong. We all belong to God, and we take care of each other and how we treat each other in the group that we belong to and outside of. We have some wonderful, wonderful students, and it was a pleasure to hang out with them. I have a few announcements. One is that Rooted will continue today at 5 p.m. for fun and games and some decent lessons, and then we resume our one-room Sunday school next Sunday as we have been in the past. So I will pass this along.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I will wish that if we can afford, please, can we stand up and put our hands while we give our word prayers to God? If you can afford to stand, you can stand. If not, you can sit down and open your hands while we pray. We thank you, Father God, for this another great day, which we are doing our part as disciples of Jesus to manifest love. As our brother, Gerard C. Rivers, had brought our brothers to talk on the our homage to Martin Luther King. Father God, we thank you for this love, and we pray that it stays on. We are giving you all the praises and believe in you, Father God, that even though we're still struggling with the pandemic, that you pour your grace to heal all those that are suffering from it. It is almost a brink of war. But we know, we believe that you will not let it happen, that another third world war happens. Father God, give the strength and the talent to our leaders to think that they will think positively to avert this war. Father God, we, like sinners, we pray that you forgive our sins, that we do not know some of them as sins. That through Jesus, as he said, forgive them, for they do not know. Forgive those that we do without knowing that they are sins, Lord, and the sins that we have committed this week. We pray that those that are not able to worship with us, just like I would commend that, whoever you think of as a family member or friend or relative or somebody that you wish to be prayed for, think about he or she as we pray now. Father God, we give you your word and we trust in you and thank you for the love we have, that you bless us, that we celebrate this day and you take us back home safely and lovely, that we meet again and celebrate and praise your name through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who died on the cross for our sins. Let us recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the kingdom, the power, and the glory forevermore. Amen.
Now, it's truly a pleasure and an honor to welcome the Peace Player drummers and Gerald C. Rivers, the voice of Dr. Martin Luther King. Let's listen.
I'll just say that these are some of my students, and they are citizens of the world. The shirts that they wear all say peace, love, and positivity, because that's what we are promoting through this music. The instruments they play are called djembes. They are West African and they are all handmade. And the word djembe literally translates as let's come together or let's gather together in peace. And so we are promoting the music, the culture, and these are all middle school students who could be any place else on a Sunday morning. But they're here with you and here with us. And literally, when we leave here today, we will continue our service and go over to Venice Beach and do a beach cleanup and do some more drumming when we are there. And so, thank you. So without any further ado, this first rhythm they play is traditionally called funga, although funga has very many rhythms and ways to play it, but it is a welcome song. And all of the songs that we play have particular meaning. And this is the song that is played when we welcome someone into a new community. And today we welcome you as you welcome us. And then they'll play cuckoo, which is a celebratory rhythm, because we don't simply commemorate Black History Month, but we celebrate it. So without any further ado, these are the Peace Players. Thank you. Thank you one more time for these young people, the Peace Player drummers. And you guys are going to get up and go take a seat. Thank you kindly for honoring them. As a tradition, when they are in class with me, whenever somebody does something really well or they're just trying really hard, we offer them love and support in the way of applause, sometimes a gentle little golf clap, but it goes a long way. First, giving honor to God, who is the source of all my strength, to the pastor, to other ministers present, to the members, friends, and family, I just want to say good morning to all of you. And to let you know what indeed an honor, a pleasure, and a privilege it is for me to have the opportunity to stand before you today. Special thanks to Miss Mary Pryor, who sees about me all over the place, and it is because of her that I am here with you today. It dawned on me when I pulled up that I have been here before for one of your cultural folk music festivals. And we brought the iteration of Peace Players who were available then. They've all grown and graduated and gone on to do other incredible things. But I just remember being here and how warm and welcoming it was. So I feel home, and that huge tree out there goes a long way for just feeling grounded. Today we are here to celebrate Black History Month, and as you may or may not know, I've spent pretty much this entire year, every Sunday, standing in someone's pulpit offering a message of peace and hope and love and courage and history and honoring. And today will be no different, yet it will be different. For those of you who don't know, I'm an actor. That's what I do by training and by trade. I make most of my living in voiceover, and unbeknownst to you, you've probably heard my voice on the radio or on television promoting various different products. I make a very good living doing that. I do cartoons, I do video games, and I've got a large campaign in Florida to get people to stop smoking cigarettes. That's what I do for a living. Being here, standing in your pulpit, and working with these young people is what I do for a life. Because it offers me hope to work with these young people. And they are as much a teacher to me as I am a teacher to them. In a couple of ways. One, they are not perfect. They are also extremely loving and patient and open and accepting in a way that some of us who have more turns around the sun have forgotten how to be. So they remind me, this age of young people today is more loving, more forgiving, more patient, more accepting than any other group of young people in the history of the world. They are our teachers. The future is not theirs. The present belongs to them. Our job is to help keep it nice for them. And there are a couple of things that we can do in order to do that. And I've been saying the same thing, and I'm sure the pastor can relate. Often there is no new message. There's only a different way to say it. And so for today, as we delve into Black History Month and celebrating these young people, the lesson I've been promoting all over is to forgive everyone. I'm going to say that again. Forgive everyone. And by forgiveness, I do not mean you are waiting for them to come to you with an apology and say, you know what I did was really wrong, and I'm really sorry, and I would like to make amends, and therefore you can forgive them. That is not forgiveness. That is negotiation. Forgiveness is to give forward. It means to give them something you don't think or believe they have earned or deserve. Now, I grew up in Compton, in the hood, if you will, and there's a saying in the hood that says you are always to give people more credit than you think they are due. There are only two possible outcomes when that happens. Either one, you will discover they were entitled to more credit than you gave them, or two, they will begin to try and live up to the credit that you just offered them. Forgive everyone, because by not forgiving them, it is literally like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. By withholding love from them, you are literally coursing toxic chemicals through your own body temple. In the words of the famous Frozen song, let it go, let it go, let it go. I don't care what they did. If you are followers of Jesus the Christ and he could stand on the cross and say, forgive them for they know not what they do, then that's the example. And if somebody hurt you, if they really understood how connected they were to you, they would not have done it. If they really understood that by hurting you, they were ultimately hurting themselves, they would have done it differently. So let it go. And that doesn't mean you have to go to them and say, now what you did was really wrong, and because I'm the bigger person, I'm going to forgive you. You just let it go in your own heart. If you don't get anything else from us today, forgive somebody you've been withholding love from. The other thing I want to say is we live in an interesting time and an interesting world, where we have more rich people, more billionaires than ever in the history of time. At the same time, we have more homeless people sleeping on the street than we have ever had in the history of the world. Something is out of kilter. If athletes and actors and artists can make millions of dollars, then we can afford to have a place for those people who are sleeping on the street to sleep. Now, here's the thing. You don't have to do everything, but you can do something. If you can't do anything else, look at a homeless person in the eyes and see them as a human being and as a child of God. So many of us, we dot our I's. We don't even want to see them. We want to pretend that they're not there. We want to look away. Just, you could change someone's life by recognizing them as a human being. Because the old tradition or adage of how people wound up on the street has changed dramatically. Some of them are there because they could not afford their medical bills, and they gave up everything to save a loved one, or to cure cancer, or to heal something that ailed them, and they find themselves on the street now with nothing. Some of them are mentally ill. They desire and need treatment and care, not disdain and disgust. Some of them are addicted to drugs and alcohol, often as a result of a traumatic experience that they have had. And some of those experiences include coming out to your family, and the family couldn't deal with it, and they began to do other things to make themselves feel better about who they were, and they wound up feeling worse. Some of them came home from the war, and I'm no longer talking about Vietnam. They came home from Iran, Iraq, Afghanistan. They're young people who saw things that go against the very nature of who and what we are. And they will forever be impacted and affected by what they saw and what they did. Just look at them. Just look at them and with your eyes say, I see you. I recognize you. I know that you are a child of the Most High in spite of the circumstances, the situation that you find yourselves in. If you don't want to give them a dollar, because I'll give them money in a minute. And people say, what, you? They may go buy drugs or alcohol. You know what? If I was at the place where I was standing on a street corner or in front of the 7-Eleven begging somebody for a quarter or change, I don't care what they're going to do with it. And I don't want them to have to explain to me or to anyone else. Here, I'm driving a Mercedes and they're standing on the side of the freeway. They don't have time to explain to me how they got there. My job in that moment is to offer them love and compassion and forgiveness for whatever they may have done that led them to where they are now. And it goes to the way we treat each other. And that launches this idea of Black History Month, because I need to say, when we talk about Black History Month, Black history does not begin with slavery. In spite of the fact that in this country we start talking about Black history, we go immediately to the escaping slaves. Well, Black history existed before there was an America. If you don't believe me, find a book by a gentleman by the name of Ivan Van Sertima, who says they came before Columbus, who proved that there were trade routes from Africa to the New World before the Europeans got here. There were pyramids, there were sphinx, there was medicine, geometry, astrology, astronomy, healing, government, societal agencies, structures to move in the world, some of which we have still not been able to figure out today. Black history begins with mysticism. In a darkness of something that we don't fully understand, but it's the same mysticism that is practiced by this person we call Jesus Christ. There are things that are unseen that are operating as forces in the universe, and Africans tapped into that. So did Jesus. Things that you could not see or fully understand were available to Black people. And the anthropologists and the historians all agree, the oldest human remains belong to that of a Black woman in a place called the Olduvai Gorge. So in theory, all of us are African. They have not found any older human remains than that of a Black woman. In the Black community, we like to call that Big Mama. We are all Big Mama's children. We all come from the same place. And ultimately, we're all going back to the same place. And in spite of the fact that Black people were taken from Africa, stolen, robbed of their language, their diet, their culture, their religion, their family, their structure, somehow we have come here and excelled. When you think about the fact that Black people were not allowed to read or write for hundreds of years, and yet during that time, there were Black people who amassed large amounts of wealth. George Washington Carver played with the peanuts, and he gave us peanut butter and over 100 uses for a single harvest, the peanut. We started celebrating Black History Month in around 29, and it wasn't a month, it was a week. Carter G. Woodson, who was only the second Black person to graduate from Harvard, decided that when he went to Harvard and got his master's, he learned nothing about Black history, as if we had no contributions. So he decided we needed a week to celebrate, commemorate, and recognize the contributions of African Americans in this country. It wasn't until 1970 that Kent State decided that a week is not enough, that we need at least a month to recognize the contributions of African Americans. And it wasn't until almost 1980 that the federal government decided that we must have a Black History Month. Now we have months for just about everything, but back then, we were happy to have it, and the joke within the Black community is they would give us the shortest month of the year. But that's all right, too. Just a couple of contributions. The stoplight. That's the invention of a Black man. The red, yellow, and green stoplight that all of you will pass today was created by a Black man with what they call a limited education. The ironing board is the invention of a Black woman. The VCR and home security systems were developed by a Black woman because she was afraid that her husband was on the road and she would be left at home. And very few of you in here now don't have a Ring doorbell, which is what it has evolved to. We have made contributions throughout this country's history. Here's what I really want to say. The resilience and the perseverance of the African American mirrors that of the resilience and the perseverance of America. It echoes the perseverance of the world. When you think about a people who have been downtrodden and things have happened and they just keep getting up, that's us. That's you. And we try to do it without too much ego. Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes my people like have to get up there and show off, which leads me to the talk I would like to present today by the late, great Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I just want you to know I've been doing these speeches, renditions, since I was 17 years old. I'm 56. They asked me when I was 21, how long do you think you're going to do this? And I said, I don't know, as long as people want to hear. And the article ended with, that could be a long time. So there are obviously great African Americans, but one of the ones that is recognized is that of Dr. King. So without any further ado, I would like to present to you the words of the late, great Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
This morning, I would like to use as a subject from which to preach the drum major instinct. The drum major instinct. And our text for the morning is taken from a very familiar passage of our Lord and Master, as recorded by St. Mark, beginning with the 10th verse or the 10th chapter, the 35th verse, we read these words. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came unto him saying, Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we shall desire. And he said unto them, what would ye that I should do for you? And they said unto him, grant unto us that we may sit one on thy right hand, the other on the left hand of thy glory. Now very quickly, we would automatically condemn James and John, and the other disciples got mad with James and John, and we can understand why. What is the answer that Jesus gave these men? He said, so that it shall not be among you, he who is great among you shall be your servant, and he who is chiefest shall be servant of all. The setting is clear. James and John were making a specific request of the Master. They had dreamed, as most Hebrews dreamed of a coming king of Israel who would set Jerusalem free, establish his kingdom on Mount Zion, and in righteousness rule the world. And they thought of Jesus as this kind of king, and they were saying, when you set up your kingdom, we want to sit one on the right hand, the other on the left hand of thy throne. Now, before we condemn them too quickly, let us look calmly and honestly at ourselves, and we will discover that we too have some of the same James and John qualities. And there is down deep with all of us a kind of instinct, a real drum major instinct, a desire to be out front, a desire to be first, a desire to lead the parade. And it is something that runs the whole gamut of life. You know, our first cry as a baby was a bid for attention. And all through childhood, we asked life to grant us first place, our little bundles of ego. Now, you know, in adult life, we still have it, and we really never get by it. We like to do something good, and you know we like to be praised for it. The only unhappy people about praise is when that praise is going too much towards somebody else. But somehow this warm glow we feel when we are praised or when our name is in print is something of the vitamin A to our ego. Don't you know that a lot of the race problem grows out of the drum major instinct? A need that some people have to feel superior. A need that some people have to feel that they are first and to feel that their white skin ordained them to be first. This tragic use, the drum major instinct, has led to some of the most tragic expressions of man's inhumanity to man. But not only does it go to the struggle between races, it goes into the struggle between nations. And I submit to you that what is wrong in the world today is that the nations of the world are caught up in the drum major instinct. I must be first. Our nation must be supreme. Our nation must rule the world. Sad to say that the nation in which we live is the supreme culprit. And I'm going to continue to say it because I love this country too much. God didn't call America to do what she's doing in the world now. God didn't call America to engage in senseless, unjust wars. But we won't stop it because of our pride and our arrogance as a nation. The God that I worship has a way of putting even nations in their place. The God that I worship has a way of saying, as the God of the Old Testament used to say, don't play with me, Israel. Don't play with me, Babylon. Be still and know that I'm God. And if you don't stop your reckless course in this world, I'll rise up and break the backbone of your power. That can happen to America. Every now and then I go back and read Gibbon's Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. And then I come back and look at America and I say to myself, the parallels are frightening. But let me rush on to my conclusion so we can see what Jesus was really saying. What is the answer that Jesus gave these men? One would have thought that Jesus would have said, you're selfish, you're out of your place. Why would you raise such a question? But that isn't what Jesus did. He did something altogether different. He said in substance, oh, I see. You want to be great? Wonderful. You want to be recognized? Wonderful. But recognize that he who is great among you shall be your servant. This morning, the thing that I like about that definition is by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great because everybody can serve. You know, you don't need a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your verb and your subject match to serve. You don't have to understand Einstein's theory of relativity to serve. You don't have to know the theory of thermodynamics to serve. You just need a heart full of grace and a soul generated by love. Every now and then I think about my own death. I think about my own funeral. I wonder what it is that I would want said. But I leave the word with you this morning. If any of you are around here when I have to meet my day, I don't want a long funeral. And if you get somebody to deliver the eulogy, tell them not to talk too long. Tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That isn't important. Tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards. That's not important. Tell them not to mention where I went to school. On that day, I want somebody to be able to say that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want them to be able to say that I tried to feed the hungry. I want them to say that I did try in my life to visit those who were sick and imprisoned. I want them to say that I did try to clothe those who were naked. I want them to say that I tried to love and serve humanity. And I won't have any money to leave behind. I won't have the fine and luxurious things of life to leave behind, but I just want to leave a committed life. That's all I want to say. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a Christian ought, if I can bring salvation to a world once wrought, if I can spread the message as the Master taught, then my living will not be in vain. Yes, Jesus, I want to be on your right ear, left side. Not for any selfish reasons. I want to be on your right or your left side, not in terms of any political ambition or kingdom, but I just want to be there in love and in justice and in truth. If you want to say that I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for peace. Say that I was a drum major for righteousness. And all of the other shallow things will not matter. God bless you.
Just thank you and thank you and thank you for having me and for sharing this time with me and my students. I just want you to know something powerful is taking place within these walls, and I feel it and I feel you. So thank you.
You deeply moved us, Gerald. We're so grateful for your ministry and bringing the spirit and the life and the words of Dr. King this morning. And these beautiful peace player drummers we're going to hear in just a moment. I feel like we need just a moment of quiet. So we're going to take a moment of silence in this moment of quiet meditation. Then we are going to sing Precious Lord, Take My Hand after that. like, we're going to go ahead and just, I want to pray, Lord, I want to thank you for the word that was brought to us this morning. The greatest among you is the one who serves. Lord, may we hear that word today. This is a message our world needs today. Forgive us for our pride. Forgive us for our hatreds, our prejudices, our pettiness, and the things that would separate us from one another. And help us, Lord, to love one another as you have loved us. Amen. And now let's pray, or sing rather, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Please stand, if you are able.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am long. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, Precious Lord, and lead me
Amen. I want to thank Deacon Mary Pryor for introducing us to Gerald and to the Peace Player drummers. Mary, where are you? There you are. Come on up.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Steve. And on behalf of the congregation of St. John's Presbyterian Church, my friend Gerald, the Peace Players, from the bottom of our hearts, we thank you for your presentation, for your words of wisdom, and for the love that you've displayed to us this morning. Words are inadequate as the gratitude that I feel every time you speak, every time I hear the drummers. My love for you grows deeper and stronger, and God grant you long life, good health, continue to spread the love throughout not only the United States, but the world. Blessings to you.
Thank you, Mary. In just a moment, our Peace Player drummers, can I say our? Can I associate myself with you? We're so grateful for our young people today who've been playing, and for Gerald Rivers. What a blessing. After the service, we are, I think, possibly having a small gathering of coffee and some cookies out there, but please say hello to one another, love one another out there on the patio. And thank you again for those of you who are joining us online today for being a part of this worship service. Just a reminder that we would ask for your prayers for our leadership retreat that's coming up this Saturday, as well as the upcoming blood drives in March, to mark your calendars for those. The Discovering St. John's class that's coming up as well, a week from now. And thank you for being a part of this community here at St. John's and for visiting us today if you're here for the very first time. And now, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
one more for you, but this one we need your participation for. So we, as I said, we are celebrating today. We are not merely commemorating, we are celebrating. So in the spirit of celebration and community and tribe and circle and all living together, we call it Wawanko. Some people call it walk the fat dog, but you are going to clap with us. And if we can play faster, then you will have to clap faster. Deal? All right, here we go.
Thank you.